zombies. That's not what you expected from the program, right? So, for a mythical entity, you can't escape them. You can't turn on the TV without running across zombies these days. Z Nation, iZombie, and the granddaddy of them all, The Walking Dead, that just refuses to die. Over the years, I've thought about this fascination with zombies, and I've even used the zombie meme at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention to push disaster preparedness. And I believe that zombies, in their various incarnations, actually represent our fear of contagion. Now, this fear of contagion, frankly, is very reasonable and very healthy, right? So microbes are really tiny. They can silently enter your body, hijack your organs, and the next thing you know, you've got a brain inflammation or a bloody fever, and you can be dead within a matter of hours. I'm a little worried about this audience here now. It's also impossible to miss or escape this fear of contagion in the daily news headlines and the near hysteria of the next epidemic. Measles in Disneyland, Zika in Miami, antibiotic-resistant superbugs in hospitals, and Ebola in West Africa. I've responded to many of these outbreaks over the course of my career, including the recent Ebola outbreak, but more on that in a moment. So I'm a disease detective. My job and my passion is to do the detective work to understand diseases as they arise and find why they arose, to try to understand how diseases are transmitted within communities, whether it's person to person or even animal to person, to try to understand who gets infected and who doesn't and why, and most importantly, to stop these diseases in their tracks. A modern day dragon slayer, if you may. Now, today I'd like to introduce you to a very dangerous idea. The idea that while we can't prevent every infection, we can make sure that the next epidemic is the last epidemic. But first, some history and even prehistory. Humans have always been infected with microbes, including the millions of microbes that live in and on us every day. So our prehistoric hunter-gatherer ancestors were susceptible to parasitic infections of the gut and likely the routine skin and wound infections from the environment that we all see. That dramatically changed about 10,000 years ago when they chose to start growing crops and domesticating animals. And that led to the first set of zoonotic infections. These are infections of animals that can infect humans. They also started to cluster together into cities, and for the first time ever, there were enough humans to sustain person-to-person-to-person infection. And so that's when we first hear reports of diseases such as measles and smallpox. Now I want you to flash forward to the turn of the 20th century. So the controversial germ theory beats out the miasma theory and leads to the sanitation revolution and a marked decline in numerous deadly human diseases. It's amazing what happens when you separate your drinking water from your toilet water. Now, we also developed vaccines that allowed us to eradicate smallpox already, and polio's on the chopping block right now. And we also now have a medicine cabinet full of antimicrobials at our disposals. Yet, despite all of this, we remain locked in a biological arms race with these ferocious little creatures. Now, they are literally microscopic, less than 1 micrometer, and macroscopic reasons why we continue to see these diseases emerge. Microbes are about 3.8 billion years old, and they're the most dominant form of life on this planet. Humans, 100,000 years or so. Microbes can reproduce in a mere 30 minutes or less. Us, takes us about 30 years. And they also have these neat tricks to swap their genetic material amongst themselves and to their offsprings that we can only marvel at. So that's why every year you need to go out and get a new flu vaccine, because the influenza virus is busy shifting and drifting its way into novel forms. And that's how microbes acquire these antibiotic-resistant genes so that we see these multi-drug-resistant bacteria for tuberculosis or gonorrhea, for example. So clearly the microbes have taken to heart Charles Darwin's observation that it's not the most intellectual of the species that survives, it's not the strongest that survives, but the species that survives is the one that is able to adapt to and adjust best to the changing environment in which it finds itself. That, I hope, has you all quaking in your boots, if nothing else. But it's not just the microbes that are changing, right? We're also changing, our behaviors are changing, and our environment is changing. These are the more macroscopic drivers of disease emergence, and especially the related epidemics. So this allows new outbreaks to emerge, make their way to huge, densely populated areas, and get started until we recognize them. Now, these factors are much more susceptible to our control. Now, some of these factors include, to start off with, I would say, mass movement of people from rural areas into urban areas for political, social, and economic reasons. So there are currently about 38 mega cities. These are cities with 10 million or more people. Tokyo is approaching about 40 million people. So this allows people and their microbes to move faster and farther than we ever have in the past. And this is as true for animals and commercial goods, of course. Jules Verne's classic, I'm sure many of you read that or were forced to read it as I was, Around the World in 80 Days, right? That's pretty quaint today when I can get to anywhere else in the world with my resident microbes hitchhiking in less than 24 hours. Now, the second of these macroscopic factors that lead to these new diseases is environmental change and habitat destruction that puts us in closer contact with wildlife and their diseases. Lyme disease is a good one from that example. But the most important is national and international politics that leads to wars, famines, poverty, terrorism, and social inequity. It's politics that drives poor health systems. Now, unfortunately, politics has also corrupted our science. If you look at things like vaccine denial, refusal, or climate change denial. Here's a climate change spiral by Professor Ed Hawkins at the University of Reading that's quite unequivocal about what's happening with climate right now, from 1815 to today. Okay, you didn't expect I'd have at least one science slide, right, in a talk? So this shows you year after year how temperature is increasing to currently approximately 1.5 degrees above baseline. So besides dramatic heat waves, climate change is going to lead to more extreme weather events, including flooding. It's going to lead to more heart and lung disease. And without a doubt, it's going to lead to changes in the habitat of birds, mammals, mosquitoes, ticks that pose risks of infections to us. Okay. Now I want to take you forward to Sierra Leone in Western Africa and my experience with the recent Ebola outbreak, the largest and most complex Ebola outbreak to date. Now, Ebola is another example of a zoonotic disease. Its natural reservoir happens to be fruit bats that are generally unaffected, but they can readily transmit disease either directly or indirectly to humans, indirectly through infected animals that you handle or eat. So I've got a question for you. This is about audience participation. You are very, very hungry, and you come across a recently dead chimp in the forest. What do you do? You don't leave it. How hungry are you? Exactly. You eat it. And so there are now a number of examples of outbreaks of Ebola started by the consumption of bushmeat. And usually it's somebody who handles or butchers the animal. It's not the person who eventually ends up eating the cooked animal. And I'll leave to you to Google after this talk, USDA website, to see what they say is the internal cooking temperature for chimp. Now, once the disease makes its way into the community, it's very contagious from person to person, starting with the first day you have fever. And this contagiousness increases every day as you become sicker, and it sort of peaks when you die, which is why the most risk of infection for you is handling a body during a funeral. And that's how one of the many ways Ebola spreads within a community. Now, in the three West African countries most affected by the recent Ebola outbreak, there were over 11,000 deaths, more than all of the prior Ebola outbreaks combined. And these deaths were completely preventable, especially in Sierra Leone, where I spent 3 months. So Sierra Leone was late to getting infected with Ebola, and the disease that was occurring for almost a year in the surrounding countries of Guinea and Liberia. And that's really more than enough time for them to have shored up their rudimentary public health systems, to be on the watch for the possible cases, and to fortify their health system so they weren't leading to infections amongst their healthcare workers and amongst their patients. So in a country where you are literally walking on underground deposits of gold and diamonds, health was not a priority. These countries chose to not develop their public health system for detection and response and were ill-prepared and poorly organized for the upcoming epidemic. These countries chose to maintain health systems without running water and basic infection control. The World Health Organization chose to fail to identify this as a global emergency until the disease spread to Europe and America. Now, it's because of these choices that the roadsides were littered with bodies, that there were shuttered healthcare facilities, that there were whole villages forcibly quarantined by the military, that people were sick and dying with their homes for the lack of transportation or treatment units, that the dead were hastily buried without last rites, while others were whisked out of their home without a word to die in a treatment unit to never be heard from again. So all of this in a background of fear and confusion. Many diseases occur in these communities that will give you a fever, a headache, muscle aches, vomiting and diarrhea, even hemorrhage, such as malaria or typhoid or dysentery. But none of those diseases had ever caught the attention of the government, let alone the international community to come and help. But even amongst this devastation, there were survivors. And I remember questioning a palm wine seller. I was trying to understand who infected him to see how the disease had made it into their community and see if other people were at risk. And so with a straight face, he looks at me and he goes, "Doc, by the time you drink enough of my palm wine, you'll have the symptoms of Ebola." So, again, very difficult to sort of pick out this disease unless you have the appropriate systems and laboratory systems in place to understand what's going on. Now, I know it seems harsh to call these choices, but that's what they are. Even inaction is a choice. The science of how to prevent and stop Ebola outbreaks is not new. We've known this since 1995, the first Ebola outbreak that I was part of. And I think that sort of brings up the darker side of being a disease detective, that often in cases like this, you're bearing witness to death and coldly calculating the sick and dying. And that raw number of 11,000 deaths, it doesn't reflect that 14-year-old in Cambia who's dying of Ebola because she had the audacity to take care of her father. It doesn't reflect the girlfriend of a healthcare worker who died after taking care of an infected patient and now is in quarantine. And it sure as heck doesn't reflect the community in Kabbalah that's going to be without healthcare for 21 days because their healthcare center had to shut down after taking care of an infected midwife who had unknowingly taken care of and delivered a pregnant woman with Ebola. And we see this pattern over and over again. In 2009, many of you will remember the big headlines about bird flu. We were busy looking for bird flu in Indonesia, and instead, we missed the epidemic of swine flu in Mexico until it spread into the United States. Today, in Saudi Arabia, we have a disease very similar to SARS that causes outbreaks within healthcare settings, but is even more contagious than Ebola because it spreads by the respiratory route. Very recently, this disease caused an outbreak in South Korea, in Seoul, which has very sophisticated healthcare systems. And this SARS-like disease poses a continued risk to us here in the United States and worldwide. Okay, finally, let's flash forward to today and now. The global community knew for over a decade about the epidemic potential of Zika. Ever since it started on the Yap Islands and started to move across the Pacific. Now, the countries in the Americas, for many years, they've ignored dengue outbreaks, yellow fever outbreaks, and chikungunya outbreaks, all caused by this exact same Aedes mosquito. And they only started paying attention to the mosquito and Zika when it became clear that the virus was associated with severe birth defects. Now, as expected, here in the United States, we've not had a large epidemic of Zika. However, we have seen a small outbreak in the Miami-Dade County area. But every one of those cases in a pregnant woman in Florida is a potential lifelong tragedy for a child born with severe brain defects. And once again, politics was at play. So for over 1 year, Congress knew that we were likely to see some cases here in the United States, and they delayed funding for a disease that primarily affects pregnant women and their infants. And because of the lack of Medicaid expansion in Florida, not unlike here in Nebraska, the health system was blind to mild cases amongst the working poor without health insurance. So epidemics, they're not an act of God. They're avoidable and preventable if we have the will to do so and are willing to allocate the resources to do so. We can buy good public health. Now you see why prevention is such a dangerous idea, because it's about accountability to me. Perpetuating a myth that epidemics are inevitable, I really think allows communities, individuals, and political leaders to shirk their responsibility to take appropriate action. I don't want to discount all the great work by the World Health Organization, the World Bank, many nations, and charities to stop epidemics. But very soon, and by that I mean now, our society and culture must take responsibility for health and the environmental, social, cultural, educational, economic conditions that lead to good health. We already have the people and talent right here in this room, I believe, to make a difference. You are powerful, and your engagement can change our national narrative to no longer accept epidemics. What is the life of that pregnant woman with Zika, that healthcare worker with SARS, or Inshata, that 14-year-old dying of Ebola, worth to you? You can start by demanding more attention to these epidemics and more science in public debates. Only you can assure accountability from city managers and politicians at the ballot box so they support public health systems, both human and infrastructure. At an individual level, you can assure you get vaccinated against influenza. You can assure that your children are vaccinated against childhood diseases like measles and cancers due to human papillomavirus. You can openly discuss the toll of sexually transmitted infections in this community and practice prevention. You can stop asking for antibiotics for the common cold when you see your doctor and ask questions when they prescribe antibiotics. You can ask your healthcare personnel to make sure they wash their hands before they touch you or a loved one. And it's only you who can stop smoking, start exercising, and eating more fruits and vegetables so that you're less susceptible to infectious diseases. The public's health is a choice, and working together, we can assure that we can bear witness to the last epidemic and hopefully also prevent the coming zombie apocalypse. Thank you.